I'd like to do now is just review a couple of experiments that show the importance of absorption of different wavelengths of light by the accessory pigments and the chlorophyll in the photosystems, and also to show an experiment which demonstrates the importance of having both photosystems active in chloroplasts. So let's look at that right now. So the first experiment I'd like to go over is one in which a filamentous algae, which has long cells and long filamentous shapes to it, can be exposed to different wavelengths of light. So for example, here we can shine blue light on this part of the filament of the algae. Here we can shine green light on the filament of the algae, and here we can illuminate this part with red light. So we're able to actually differentially illuminate the photosynthetic algae along a length of a particular filament. And then what can be added are oxygen-seeking, O2-seeking bacteria. And these bacteria can chemotax, that is, they can move, they will migrate using flagella to areas of high O2 concentration. And what do you think happens? Well, the O2 sensing bacteria accumulate at very high cell densities in this area of the filament. And also in this area of the filament, they accumulate at high cell densities. They migrate, in other words, they chemotact to these areas, but only relatively few are found in intermediate areas. And how would you interpret that, knowing what you know about photosynthesis? Well, you realize that the absorption spectra for the pigments found in the photosystems absorb in the blue range, very little in the green range, and again in the red range. So these absorption, if we look at the absorption at various wavelengths of light, and here we plot wavelengths of light, this would be bluish light, this would be red light, we see that there's high oxygen production then in this area of the filament and in this area of the filament because the oxygen sensing bacteria move to those areas. And so oxygen is being produced here in oxygenic photosynthesis. And that is because of the absorption spectra of the photosynthetic pigments. And we've already shown you absorption spectra graphs of that. So this is a very nice bioassay. It doesn't involve any biochemistry at all. It's a bioassay using the behavior of bacteria to show that photosynthesis in the algae is high in when illuminated by blue light and red light, but not by intermediate wavelengths of light, showing again the absorption peaks of the photosynthetic pigments in these areas. Now another experiment which shows the importance of both photosystems in chloroplast photosynthesis is it's called the a synergistic effect or an enhancement effect. If we look at time here, we do an experiment and we look at rates of photosynthesis here, we'll just call it photosynthetic rates. And you illuminate cells with light at particular times, let's say at this time. And at this time you illuminate with, we'll say, far red light. We'll get an increase in photosynthesis. And then we turn that far red light off, photosynthesis drops off. And then if at another time, we illuminate with red light, we see photosynthesis picking up again until we turn that red light off. So here is on, off of far red light, and here is on of red light and off of far red light, and again photosynthesis decreases. Now, if at this point we illuminate with both red and far red light, we see a big boost in photosynthesis, a synergistic effect in photosynthesis, and here we turn that light off, both far red and red light. So what we see, though, is that the rates of photosynthesis occurring with far red light and the rates of photosynthesis occurring with red light are not as great if you added them together to account for illumination with both wavelengths of light. That is, this great increase here, which is more than the sum of the rates of photosynthesis from either of those lights alone, this is a synergistic effect. Synergistic effect of both wavelengths of light on photosynthetic rates. And this basically gives us the importance, synergistic effect, or this enhancement effect of using both red and far red light shows the importance of both photosystems, because here we are activating photosystem one, and here we are activating photosystem two. Remember, photosystem two has a reaction center with a peak absorbance of 680. I'm sorry, I have these reversed. This would be, oh no, I have that right. Photosystem two. Remember that photosystem two has a reaction center with an absorbance peak at 680 nanometers, whereas photosystem one has a reaction center with an absorbance peak with a reaction center with an absorbance peak at 700. That is far red light, and P680 represents red light. So here we see the synergistic effect of utilizing both photosystems in producing photosynthesis. So this is a nice demonstration then of both photosystems one and two acting together to produce photosynthesis in the light-dependent reaction. So of course these are all light-dependent reactions. And now we're ready to tackle what happens to the molecules produced by the light-dependent reaction, that is ATP, lots of it through chemiosmosis, and NADPH through electron transfer, through oxidation of NADP. We can now see how these molecules are utilized in the light-independent reactions. That is the fixation of carbon from CO2. We have fixation of carbon from CO2 into organic molecules like glucose, C6H12O6. And this then is the goal of photosynthesis, to produce food using the light energy, by the harvesting of light energy by these photosynthetic light-dependent reactions. So that's where we'll tack what that's what we'll tackle next, are the light-independent reactions. All right, now we've covered the light-dependent reactions of photosynthesis. Let's move on to the Calvin cycle, or the light-independent reactions. And these are the carbon fixation reactions, and we know that to build carbohydrate, cells need energy, of course, and we derive that energy from ATP that is produced by the light-dependent reactions and mechanisms we've already talked about. And we need reduction potential provided by reduced NADP or NADPH. And this comes from photosystem one, as we have seen. So, what is the biochemical pathway that fixes carbon? It's called the Calvin cycle, named after Melvin Calvin, a plant physiologist. And this is the pathway that fixes carbon. It occurs in the stroma of the chloroplast. Remember that we have a chloroplast with an outer membrane here and an inner membrane. And then we have the thylakoids that are stacked into grana. The outside of the thylakoids, we have the stroma, stroma, stroma. So this is occurring in the stroma. The Calvin cycle is in the stroma of the chloroplast. And as we've discussed, ATP and NADPH are used for the energy that drives these biochemical reactions. So the trick is to incorporate carbon from gaseous carbon dioxide into organic molecules, and in that way, to build food, to build sugars that will sustain all of life on Earth, essentially. And CO2 incorporated in organic molecules occurs in the very first step of the Calvin cycle. So the first step involves taking carbon and fixing it in an organic molecule. And this is the reaction of that first step of the Calvin cycle. So ribulose bisphosphate, which has five carbons in it, we can refer to this as RuBP. RuBP plus a one carbon from CO2 is put into a six carbon intermediate that is then converted into two molecules of phosphoglycerate, 3-phosphoglycerate, and that has three carbons in them, so in each of those. So we have taken a five carbon compound, added a single carbon from carbon dioxide, produced transiently a six carbon molecule that is then cleaved into 2 3-carbon molecules. So you can see that we've taken the one carbon from carbon dioxide and put it into an organic molecule. That carbon exists as one of the carbons in one of these 3-carbon, 3-phosphoglycerate molecules. And the enzyme that catalyzes this reaction is known as Rubisco, R-U-B-I-S-C-O, Rubisco. It's one of the most abundant enzymes on the planet because of all the photosynthesis that's occurring on Earth. And that is Rubisco. And we will see that Rubisco, this enzyme, which is a large enzyme consisting of many subunits, has certain properties that make this process of carbon fixation not entirely efficient, and that's kind of an artifact of evolution that we will consider shortly, but not right now. Let's move on to the Calvin cycle itself and look at the entire cycle. And that's what we'll pick up with in the next part of this lecture. We'll look at the Calvin cycle and look at its organization into three major phases.